It always gives me great pleasure to be at this forum because I've been speaking at this forum annually since 1999. So this is my 16 or 17 year speaking here. On different topics, today I will speak about revegetation of fescue grassland. As you know, fescue grassland is very important in terms of the habitat values it provided to many of the wildlife and also to the rangeland and so on. So I'm not going to go and repeat what's the importance of fescue grassland, but today it's under threat from industrial development and also like fragmentation and so forth. So in my presentation today, I'll talk about some of the work we did at Del Bonita lately on trying to restore fescue grassland. And prior to that, we did lots of work on fescue grassland in the Longview area in southern Alberta. And lately there was an opportunity to do some work in the east side. And that's why I'm going to talk about the Del Bonita site, which is by Cardston, and also to look at some of the treatments we use in trying to establish native fescue vegetation. And that site is fairly young, it's only about 2 years since seeded. So I'll just present some of the preliminary results and then the plan moving forward. So this is the Del Bonita site. Like in 2011, Shell had some lease interest there in that region. And there was a piece of land, which is a fescue grassland, was broken and seeded to agriculture. So Shell provided us about 1 hectare of that land, and we thought it would be a good opportunity to use that one and see what else we can learn about restoring fescue. So what you see on this slide is the soil characteristics of a site. Basically, like bulk density, no issues there, you know, 1.3. pH, great. EC, no concern. Pretty well, it was a good site to do some fescue restoration. So what you see right now is just the site. On right here, you see this is all cultivated, the field, and this is the native, what we established in 2011. So what we have about 1 hectare size, we have about 3 reps. We look at seed, because sometimes you have various options as to what you use in establishing fescue. We look at a seed mix by itself. We also look at plugs, and also seed plus plugs. And also we're trying to use native hay. But native hay, the challenge with that sometimes is not a good seed producing year, so we did not collect native hay, so we just use it as a natural regeneration site. And right now, just see the replication and the treatments and the size of the plots. This is a seed mix, because lots of questions, like when you have a particular disturbances, people actually like, what do you seed? Like, what is the composition? There's no standard seed mix per se. Different companies come up with their own seed mix. But we put up this one based on what we think the background community should look like. And only here, I put down the percent of a mix and also the percent germination, very important in devising your seed mix. And one more thing, like when we do the seed mix, we base it on what is the seeding rate going to be on pure live seeds. Not just 10 kilo per hectare or 18 kilo, we base it on pure live seeds. And in order to figure your seeding rate, you need the 1,000 kernel weight, because your germination multiplied by your purity of your seeds give you pure live seeds. And then when you divide your percent, 2% of June grass, the amount of seeds in 2% of June grass is not the same as 2% of seed in Western Porcupine. That's why sometimes if you don't do the calculation right, you will have a particular site that has much more June grass or much more Rocky Mountain fescue than you anticipated, and you wanted to know how it happened. Because fine seeds, like in 1 gram of fine seeds, there's millions of seeds compared to thousands in heavy seeds. So that's why I want to draw your attention to the importance of knowing the 1,000 kernel weight and the pure live seeds. So this one, we got the site in the fall of 2011. Then in spring of 2012, we established the site. And basically, we used a combination of plugs, like you see there, various plugs that were collected from the area in 2011, germinated and grow at AITF. And this, we just use a zero-till seeder to establish the site. And of course, this is the fescue plugs planted in 2012. And of course, when you establish fescue grassland, sometimes people have better luck in the spring, others have better luck in the fall. If you have to develop a prescription, people ask you, where would I have better success, is spring or fall? So we look at both of them. And this one is the fall planting. And fall planting, we did it towards the end of October. And it was warm that day, then the weather was changing very fast on us as we were planting, the ground was getting frozen. So what you see right now is the fall planting again. We did the seeding in the fall, the plugs planting, this is a fescue, and this is what the plugs look like. It was just all frosty and dormant. And the reason we look at fall planting, because if the plugs are dormant, you have less of a transplanting shock. So that implies that you will have more success, but then does it really work? So I'll show you that, you know, this again, like we analyze all the data, we did some statistics on that just to look at, you know, comparison, what's worked best or not. In this one now, just go over some of the results. This is year one after establishing the plot in 2013. And this is basically what you see right now is the germination. I put this down here because the germination is very important when you do your seed mixes. So because we did lots of collection, and we don't only use grasses, we use lots of plugs that are important for ground nesting birds. Because end of the day, if you are reclaiming a particular disturbed site, it's not only that we want to meet criteria, because I think we can do that very well, but we want to see what habitat values we are bringing to that piece of land. In this case, like whether I can put my cattle back in a few years, or does it support the wildlife, the birds, and so on, what you want to see on that land. So that's why we put lots of forbs to provide structure, but also to provide nutrition to wildlife species. So when you look at time of planting, whether it's spring versus fall, you see quite a big difference between fall planting and spring planting. Although we have much better success in spring planting, but to me, I think this is more attributed to the site condition, because we were planting in late fall, so the plugs did not have enough time to put new roots to anchor to the ground. So when you have freeze fall, it warms again, and the plugs pop up out of the ground, and this set back the survival of the plugs. So that's why in this case, you see big difference that spring planting is doing better. But if you move back to the Longview area, you may have better success. In fact, we had better success with fall planting than spring planting. So the site conditions dictate very well like the kind of success you will have. And I talk about the temperature we're having, like weather play a huge part on the type of success you have. Like in this case, like where it was frozen, we have frozen plugs, we think everything will be dormant, and then the temperature starts to rise again, you get that warm spell. And many of the plugs mm-hmm. start to green up again, and then when it freezes again, guess what, the plants doesn't have enough time to survive, to adapt. That's why you see that big difference, but the spring is doing better than fall. But that would be more of a, like I said, more of a site variability compared, for example, the east to the west site. When you talk about native hay treatment again, like this is what you see right here is the result of the plugs we planted in the fall. So coming back in spring, many of the plugs did not survive, so all you have now is a dead plug. But in many other part of the treatment where we were supposed to use native hay, for 2 years in a row, we did not get native hay because fescue does not produce seed every year. So it depends on weather or particular type of variability in order whether you have early spring or long, for them to produce seeds. So in both years, we did not have seed production. So the site was empty. That's why you see lots of pasture sages and lots of other weeds. That was the beginning. But with time, in 2014, we went back to the site, we tried to look at plant cover. And we see that we look at the treatment, there's no difference, no significance between the treatments. Also, although it differ from among grass, forbs, and weeds, and so on, you see spring is doing better, but the difference between the different treatments were not. In all of them, you have quite an amount of plant cover not occurring. And if you look at soil cover by treatment, again, you see the same trend continue, where among the different seed mix, from spring seeder to seed plus plug and so on, you see difference, but it's not really significant. So basically, in about 2 years' time, you see lots of ingress happening from adjacent areas into the plots, which is really good because this is what you want to happen in case of diversity. You want whether it come by wind or by rain or whatever, you want the seeds, you want the ingress to naturally occur. And this one, just to show you some of the plugs, how well we are doing in the summer of 2014. Many of the plugs are flowering or blooming nicely and are shedding seeds. And here it's lots of over grasses doing really nicely, back into seed. And you will see that throughout the whole site, whether the one which is not seeded and cedar too, lots of cover. And if you look at the site last year, like, you know, look at the litter, because we did move at site a couple of times to manage some of the non-desirable species, like the weeds, the flix weed and so on. And in terms of that, you get lots of organic matter on the ground, which contribute to the nutrient cycling. Of course, with any site you have, like in non-native foragers, is always an issue. Like when we were at Longview, we have lots of issues with timothy and smooth broom. But when you move back to the coastal area, you have a different species. Cheatgrass is everywhere. And no matter how good a site you started, and cheatgrass just pop up, you know, and out of nowhere. So by year two, we have lots of cheatgrass opening right at the entrance where the vehicle goes by and cattle gathered and so on, lots of cheatgrass. So we spent the first year like just pulling cheatgrass out, trying to stop its spread. And in the second year, it got worse. No matter what you do, still see much cheatgrass. So that is one of the major challenge about no matter like how good a job you do from seeding to reach your destination, your final plant community. But what happened, how you manage a site play a great part whether you achieve that or not. Like in this case, unless like we are managing the cheatgrass right here, but if nobody does anything on the adjacent areas, guess what? You will have constant pressure from cheatgrass. So we went back again to the site and we just tried to mow it again and try mow it, get rid of the weeds and the cheatgrass, pull it out and take it away. So this is the site, how it looks after 2 years of establishment. Does not matter whether it's the plot area that were left blank, no seeding, and even those are the seeded plugs, but all of them look fantastic, I think, you know, compared to the native one. So in conclusion, we see definitely better establishment from spring seeding, but this will vary from site to site. And whether you use forbs, legumes, and so on to enhance the diversity of your site, it's a great idea because it gives your site structure, it gives your site like more diversity, and you can reach that reclamation target way faster. A combination of plugs and seeds is always great, but you have the option, and how you source your plant materials, make sure they are as indigenous as you can get them. And if this trend continues, I think a site like that could, you know, should not be an issue if you want to seek a reclamation certificate in 5 years. Again, continue with that, like with conclusion, like we see whether you use seeds or seeds alone, like in a couple of years or 3 years, you should be able to certify that sites. And one other thing I would caution, though, like you just go and monitoring a site is not good enough, because you want to be able to monitor, but at the same time, you need to have a management practices. What are you doing to that land? If you don't have a weed management plan in place, you don't have a site management plan, but all what you have, you will have problem down the road. So it's always important to manage the surroundings so that you're sure that your ecological path is the right one. Because otherwise, all what you will find is false at the end, but you're not doing a good job. But in fact, you are doing a good job. You start with the right site, right seed mix, simply your management plan fails. That's why I think like it's very important to have a weed management plan, a site management plan. And the reason I say that, because from my experience, I did that project in 2011, looking at various sites, stratifying sites by age from 3 years to 15 years, from the dry grassland all the way to the parkland, looking at when is reclamation success achieved. No matter which site you go for in this province, you have very good structure in terms of native species composition, good litter recycling, good nutrient cycling, but the problem is same. Weeds everywhere, because nobody does anything. All they do, they monitor, but nobody goes out to pull the toad flax or the alfalfa that is creeping in. So when you go there in about 5 years or 10 years time, trying to apply for a REC certificate, of course you cannot pass any other site. Why? Because you've got problems on what is occurring. But while monitoring, if you are out there already, you have your weed management plan in place, it doesn't take long to do some cosmetic herbicide application or pooling, you would have reversed that site condition. Get rid of alfalfa. This is alfalfa by Brooks area in a dry mixed grassland. This one is toad flax in the parkland. Despite you get nice parkland area there, but toad flax all over. And because of that, you have to fail a site. You know, which is like, you know, what do you do now, 10 years, 12 years later? Do you go and spray everything and restart again? It sets you back. So that's why, from my experience, it's important to have a weed management plan in place so that you continuously try to manage your site. So going forward, again, being me, being common sense, like what is the value? Reclamation certificate, yes, I think this is not an issue, like, you know, in terms of how we do reclamation. But to me, like, does it provide the habitat values that we want this piece of land to provide? In this case, if I was a rancher, can I put my 2 head cattle back into that land and get the grazing value I'm seeking, the animal units per hectare? Or does it provide the habitat for the ground nesting birds or ferruginous hawk or whatever piece of wildlife that want to use that land? So this is what I want to monitor in the future, to see what is habitat value that piece of reclaimed land provide. And also moving forward, I want to be able to work with, because with our organization, like Fescue Grassland, doesn't happen in the coastal area alone. Fescue Grassland is at Watertown, Jumping Pound by Calgary, the lower foothills. I want to be able to work with other entities like the Foothills Forum, the Southern Alberta Community Initiative, and Jane and Jane Lancaster and a group, trying to develop a more regional approach. How do we restore and engage the public in restoring Fescue Grassland, and also educating the young people from school and so on the value of Fescue Grassland, how we have to maintain it and preserve the integrity of a native, of a remaining native grassland. With that, I want to say thank you to all the people that support me, from PTAC to the AUPRF team, Shell, who provided support and also finding the sites, and some of our landowners like Chris Chataway, the Blades, and the Newton Ranch, but also support us.